And now let's all play What's My Line? And now, live from New York, let's meet our What's My Line panel. First, the delightful star of stage and television, Miss Arlene Francis.
And now a gentleman who gives the most superb, spectacular performance of the current season in the musical hit, What Made Sammy Run, What Makes Him Run, Mr. Steve Sammy Glick Lawrence.
Thank you. On my left, the very lovely, talented, and charming Miss Dorothy Kilgallen.
On my left, another wonderful actor and great game player, Martin Gabel.
Now, a man whose lucidity of expression will be used to darken and obscure the truth, Mr. J.C. Daly.
Well, I must say, I want to share in the remarks that Arlene made, Steve. As a matter of fact, the New York critics were so complete in their praise of your splendid performance that we felt we had to go to some rather special ends since you were with us tonight. So, panel, get your masks ready. We are going to have two mystery guests tonight, complete.
Wow.
So that we can have a rather special celebration of Steve's great success. We have some interesting occupations as well as our mystery guests. And we'll meet the first of the mystery guests after this. All right, panel, remembering now that this is the first of two mystery guests tonight, I must ask if your blindfolds are all in place.
Yes, John.
Yes, John.
In that event, will our first mystery guest enter and sign in, please? Remember, panel, one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise. And we'll begin with Arlene Francis.
Would your name appear in the entertainment pages of the paper?
Nope.
That's one down and nine to go, Mr. Lawrence.
No.
Was that a no?
That was a no.
Would it appear in the sports section of a newspaper? Yep.
Miss Kilgallen?
Is your sport one which uses equipment?
Yep.
Mr. Gabel?
Is your sport a seasonal sport?
Yep.
Miss Francis?
Would it be baseball?
Yep.
Mr. Lawrence?
Would you be on one of the local New York teams? No.
Two down and eight to go. Miss Cordell?
Are you on a West Coast team?
Nope.
Three down and seven to go, Mr. Gabel?
No. Nope.
Nope.
Are you or were you on a team in the Middle West?
Yep.
Miss Branson?
Are you a manager rather than a performer in the sport?
Nope.
Four down, six to go, Mr. Lawrence.
Would your position be in the infield rather than the outfield? I mean, any place from second base to home. I mean, you know, from first, second,
player.
Third, short, or home. As opposed to... Yes, I don't see why I'm explaining this to you. You don't know what I'm talking about. You're in the wrong game.
Okay. Okay.
Yep.
Yep. Ms. Kilgallen?
Yep.
What is he, an infielder?
Well, it was first,
the
second,
issue
third,
was,
short,
is his position in the infield.
I defer to Mr. Gabel.
Yes.
Did you play for the St. Louis Cardinals?
Yep.
Are you Stan Musial?
Lots of fun. Good idea. I don't know what's going, but I know we'll kick all the cards over. And
May I congratulate you for my colleagues and I guess for everybody who's in the theater and everybody in the country on your appointment to direct the president's physical fitness program.
Yes, fine, John. Thank you. I'm very highly honored to be a part of President Johnson's physical fitness program. Of course, there's nothing better than the physical fitness of the youth of our country, so I'm very proud about that.
Yeah. You have every reason to be it. I must say that if you're one of the youth of the country, you sure look fit, mister. That's all I got to say.
Well, fine, John.
Can I ask you to tell a story? Actually, I've had the good fortune to know Stan because we share a good mutual friend named Toot Shore, as Martin did, too. And Toots once told me a story. Would you please not beat that microphone up just because you're fit, Stan? Now, come on. That's the only microphone we got in that position tonight. You can't do this. It's still working. Bang, bang.
Boom.
Now, but you remember the story Toots told me once that you hit 330, I think it was, at 1962, and the late President Kennedy called you. He called you on the phone and said, sent you a message.
Oh, yes. He said, something about... Here I'm 42 and hitting 330, and when I should be retiring, and I'm still a young fella. He believed in our youth. He really did.
And I think he said, though, that you make it true that life begins at 40.
Right, right.
Is that what he said? That's the story as I remember.
Right. No, that's right.
Well, I must say, it's a challenge. If we had to read some of the statistics in the papers, our young folks need to be inspired to a greater interest in physical fitness, and... inspiration is something you sure have got for him, so I'm sure that you're going to have a very successful tour of duty.
Well, fine, John.
Thanks for staying up so late and coming to visit us, Stan. Wonderful to have you with us. All right, now to meet our first regular challenger. Will you enter and sign in, please? Nancy Henry. Miss or Mrs. Henry?
Mrs.
Mrs. Henry, I must say, that's as good a job with a chalk as I've seen in many years. That's wonderful.
I'm proud of it.
A fine job it is. Would you tell us where you're from?
Somerset, New Jersey.
Somerset, New Jersey. That's nearby, is it? Is it across the river?
Oh, right across the river.
Right across the river. Mm-hmm. Fine. Mrs. Henry, may I present our panel? Now, will you join me over here, please? And we'll let the audience in the theater and the audience at home know exactly what your line is. All right. Now we can tell you that Mrs. Henry is salaried and deals in a product, and I think we'll begin the general questioning with Martin Gabel.
Mrs. Henry, is your product something that would be useful to me?
Definitely.
Is it something that's more useful for men than women?
No.
One down and nine to go, Miss Francis.
Is it a product that's found in the home, Mrs. Henry?
Yes.
Would it be found in any particular part of the home more than another?
No.
Let me have a small moment.
John would keep it in a different room.
All right, fine. Mrs. Henry agrees, Arlene, that we might mislead you. We will agree that the product in the home might tend, in most circumstances, to be located in one place rather than anywhere at all around the house. So to that degree, we'll give you a qualified yes.
Well, I can be sure that you'll give me a qualified no when I ask you whether it is something that might be kept in the kitchen or dining room.
Could be, yes.
It could be, but we stress the could be.
I see. May I rule out that it is something to eat?
Yes.
Is it some sort of equipment of some kind that one might use in the home?
Yes.
Well, now, when you speak of equipment here, you have reference to the normal home appliances that one would use either electrically or otherwise powered.
I don't know. What do you have in mind, John?
The lucidity of expression I was talking about.
Well, the thing of the lucidity of expression requires here, because I think it would be confusing if I give you
John.
A no. We won't we won't describe this as equipment. 2-8 to go, Mr. Lawrence.
If it's not equipment, can I rule out that it doesn't have any electrical parts?
Yes.
Can you rule out that it doesn't? The double negative being affirmative?
I mean that it... I can rule out that it does not have electrical parts. And not, you don't have to plug it in to work it.
Correct.
Good. I can rule out that it's not transistorized, too. Is that right?
Yes. Oh, yes.
All right. Now, this product that you have can be found in the kitchen and the dining room and, for that matter, almost anywhere else in the home.
You could, yes.
You could. Would it have anything to do with making you more comfortable?
I can think of circumstances where it would make you feel more comfortable, yes.
Yes. You don't know me very well, but would I have it in my home?
You? I would think so.
Sure.
Well, the way you said that, I think I better get rid of it real quick.
With you running, you'll need it.
Oh.
Oh-ho. Oh-ho-ho.
This product that you have, can it be worn?
Yes.
Can it be worn, outside of, like, clothing? Can I rule out that it is not a piece of clothing that you can wear like a...
Can you rule out that it is not a piece of clothing?
Yes.
No.
So your question is it a piece of clothing?
No, that's not my question, John. That's your question. I mean, you can rule it out that it is not clothing. That's something that you would wear, like some sort of...
Now, your question is...
My question evidently
is... This is something one would wear that is not a piece of clothing.
Right.
That's your question.
Yes.
That's right.
Well, I'm ahead so far, yes. I think I'm up a blind alley. I'd better pass to Dorothy.
Mrs. Henry, when you wear this product, is it generally out of sight?
No.
That makes it 3 down and 7 to go, Mr. Gabel.
You could have done that well.
Is it made of something other than clothing material?
Yes.
Could it be defined as some kind of makeup?
No, I don't think we could define it as makeup, Martin.
Well, if it were a wig, John, it would be...
I would agree with you then.
Oh, thank
you. It was. But this is no muck it this, as
Got
we
it,
say.
John.
That's 4 down and 6 to go, Miss Francis.
Oh. Would it be seen from the waist up?
Yes.
Would it be seen from the shoulders up?
Yes.
Would it be seen in the area of the face?
Certainly.
And it is not makeup. That's been ruled out, has
That's
it not?
That's been ruled out.
And that includes false eyelashes and beards.
And eyeballs. Mm-hmm.
What else is it? Yes, I know it's not muzzles because he shouldn't have one of those. So, can we have a conference for 1 second?
You can have 30 seconds for a conference.
After, if it shows more when you smile.
Does it show more when you smile, Mrs. Henry?
No.
Thank you, Dorothy.
5 down and 5 to go. Steve, it's your turn again.
Well, I take it by that it wouldn't show more when you frown. But would it be anything... From the nose up?
Certainly.
We're narrowing it down now. We're closing in. Yes. It can be anywhere on the face?
Yes.
It's a veil.
Steve would hardly wear a veil, or more than either.
No, goodness no. Would it be a wig of some kind?
No.
No. 6 down and 4 to go. I'm going to give you one more minute because you're floundering here.
Is this made of material?
Yes.
And it is seen when it's worn. Is it worn on the front of the face as well as the back of the head?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Does it cover any portion of the face?
Yes.
Does it cover the forehead?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, what, Arlene?
I'm not going to tell you.
I loused you up.
You made trouble for me. I'll make trouble for you.
Is it any kind of a mask?
No.
No.
7 down and 3 to go. Martin?
With all this perfect cross-examination has been going on. I am some leagues behind where I was when we began asking the questions now. It's not a mask, it's not a wig, it's not makeup, and it's not material such as clothing material.
It is material.
It's made material, but not such as clothing material.
Not such as clothing material. I pass to my wife.
Oh. May I rule out leather?
Sure.
All right. Is it anything you can see through?
I guess some of them are. Because I'm going to turn all the cards over. Let's see if you guess.
I'd like to be... I've been watching this program for a long time. I'd like to be the first one in 14 years to give up.
What is your product? I give up.
Anybody got any... Dorothy, do you have an idea?
No.
Band-Aid?
It's not a towel, is it?
What?
Band-Aid. Mr. Johnson and Johnson Band-Aid.
John, to me, a Band-Aid is someone who works with an orchestra.
I've been missing Bennett, sir, for that moment.
We get rid of Bennett, we get him all the way down in South America, and then look what happens to us. Steve comes and does it to us. What is the technical name?
I'm an inspector packer of the Band-Aid brand adhesive bandages. I inspect it to see that you get the very best, and I pack it.
Oh. An adhesive bandage, I guess, is the full name.
You inspect Band-Aids?
If you use Band-Aid, and it's not a Band-Aid, if you use it as a generic term, you get a letter from Johnson & Johnson.
Right.
Yeah, good show. Mrs. Henry, thank you. It was fun puzzling the panel, and thank you for helping to do it. Nice to see you. We'll meet tonight's second mystery guest in just a moment after this word from our sponsor. And now the second go-round with mystery guests, and that requires that my colleagues on the panel once again blindfold themselves. The process of doing so now in being, is it all over? You've got the blindfolds all securely on, Pat?
Yes, John. Yes.
Will our second mystery guest enter and sign in, please? So once again, I would remind you that it's one question at a time, in turn, moving clockwise. And we'll begin with Steve Lawrence.
Are you in the entertainment business?
Yes, I am.
Have you ever been a member of this panel?
Upon occasion.
I love you, whoever you are.
Oh, dear.
Mutton.
Are you now appearing on Broadway?
In front of my hotel, yes.
That's one bad time to go.
Did you go to California this morning?
I told somebody I was.
Well, I'll tell you, since I believe everything you've told me, Steve, I don't believe it's you. Because if you told me you went to California, I believe that it's not Steve Allen.
Yeah, it is. Never seen one come apart so quickly.
What a disguise.
Now, but we've got to fill in the puzzle. The wonderful thing about this is you all know what Steve Lawrence has meant to Steve Allen and vice versa. And Steve Allen and his bride came in from California just to go and see Steve Lawrence in What Makes Sammy Run. And they went to the theater Saturday night and afterwards went through an elaborate proceeding of saying goodbye.
I took them home. Everything we hugged and carried on.
We were
like a parting scene. Oh, boy, I won't see
you. Dean and I were yawning. We kept saying, Steve, I'm sorry, we have to catch a plane at 9 in the morning, so we'll see you in a few months.
I should have known better than to trust you, Steve Allen.
But it didn't work. Well, because actually it worked for about 10 seconds. You asked that first
just
question.
About.
Just about dead.
Steve Allen is probably the greatest talent of the world, but you're a terrible impressionist.
Steve, thanks a lot. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, with such a brilliant recovery, we'll have to agree, panel, that you get some congratulations, and we'll have another contestant after this word from our alternate sponsor. And now, our final contestant, will you enter and sign in, please? Tony Wilson. I'm just about. All right. Mr. Wilson, where are you from?
I'm from Yonkers, New York.
Yonkers, New York.
Right.
Nice to have you with us. May I present the panel? If you'll join me over here, we'll tell the audience at home and the audience in the theater exactly what your line is. All right, panel, we can tell you that Mr. Wilson is salaried and deals in a product, and we'll begin the general questioning with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Could I use your product, Mr. Wilson?
Yes, I think so.
Could I lift it?
Yes.
May I rule out that it's anything to eat?
No.
One down and nine to go, Mr. Gabel.
Is it something to eat?
Yes, it
is. Is it something that one would be more likely to have at dinner than at breakfast?
No, I would think not, Martin. Two down and eight to go, Miss Francis.
Is it a solid rather than a liquid?
Sometimes.
Sometimes?
Sometimes.
Yes.
Yes.
It's sometimes solid and sometimes liquid.
Yes.
Does that mean that it could melt?
It could, yes. Very
difficult. Is it kept in the refrigerator?
No.
Three down and seven to go, Mr. Lawrence.
Oh, that completely threw me. It's sometimes liquid and sometimes solid.
I'd like to do that.
You'd have it at breakfast time, you did say, yes. Would it be anything like in the juice family?
No.
Four down and six to go, Miss Kilgallen.
Is it a dairy product?
No, it's not.
Five down and five to go, Mr. Gabel.
Is it some form of Jell-O?
No.
Six down and four to go, Miss Francis.
Is there any fruit associated with it?
No,
not
directly.
Not directly. Seven down and three to go, Mr. Lawrence.
Bring back Steve Allen.
Oh.
Can we have a short conference?
You can have 30 seconds for a conference.
Maybe it's something you mix up like that makes a batter like pancakes. I mean, that's probably wrong.
Is it something that you mix up like a batter in pancakes?
Like a batter in pancakes or like a batter in baseball, though? That's eight down and two to go, Miss Cook.
Is it an egg?
An egg, no. Nine down and one to go, Mr. Gable.
Is it eaten at dinner as well as breakfast?
It can be,
yes.
Would you call it a vegetable?
No.
It's over.
Now, come on, honey. You all know the answer to this one, don't you, honey? Huh?
Oh, it's honey.
Honey? Mr. Wilson is of the Wilson. R.B. Wilson?
Yeah.
R.B. Wilson.
It's when is it in the comb?
They crystallized it, Dorothy.
When it's crystallized.
Don't you ever eat honey from the honeycomb? I do.
Creamed honey,
and they crystallized it. Okay. One thing that'll interest you is that Mr. Wilson's involved in the flower show because, as a part of their business, they have so much beeswax left over after the honey that there are candles at the
market. We make candles.
They make candles from the beeswax.
We handle candles.
And that's
handle candles.
Thank you very much, sir. It was nice
Thank
to puzzle the panel with you, too. Thanks for coming. And there again, may I say it's a joy to have had you with us, Steve. And, Martin, wonderful to see you there. And good night to Mrs. Gabel.
Good night, Mr. Danny. Good night, dear Steve. Long, long run.
Thank you very much, Arlene. And good night, John. Nice to see you. Good night, John.
Same for me, too, about the show. Good night, Martin.
Good night, Dorothy. Nice seeing you.
John,
always a pleasure. Good night, Martin. And good night, Bennett, sir, wherever you are. And thanks for being with us on What's My Line.
What's My Line is a CBS Television Network production in association with Mark Goodson and Bill Cotton. Johnny Olson speaking.